The creator of Tintin was George Remy, but to the world, he was better known as Hergé, a pen name coined by reversing his initials to make RG, or in French, Hergé. Here he is. Hergé was the master of a human comedy, in which the best known character is, of course, Tintin. A model for adolescence, a reporter and world traveler, Tintin can escape from any tight corner. And Tintin is accompanied by Snowy, like Don Quixote with Sancho Panza. Snowy and Tintin share the same values. This is just as well, for Snowy also has his weaknesses. More than a companion, he's an accomplice. Snowy is often overshadowed by the tremendous personality of Captain Haddock. Haddock is no model, of course. He is perhaps the most human of all the Tintin characters, a man of excesses, but honest and loyal to a fault. Just see how devotedly he looks after Professor Calculus. Calculus is science. It's hard to communicate with the professor, though he's never short of words. La Castafiori, the ear-splitting diva of classical grand opera. She's Captain Haddock's nightmare. And then there are Thompson and Thompson of the special branch. Comedians who think they are detectives. But the two Thompsons, Snowy, Haddock and La Castafiori, are only the main characters among the hundreds who appear in the works of Hergé, the man known as the Balzac of the comic strip.
J'ai été élevé dans une famille très modeste, tout petits employés, famille très unie également, où mon frère et moi, nous avons été entourés de beaucoup d'affection. Quant à l'époque, je me souviens surtout, bien sûr, de celle d'après-guerre, au moment où la Belgique se remettait de cette guerre et où elle pensait ses plaies, où elle était encore groupée, assemblée autour de son roi, Albert. Bref, l'impression générale dont je me souviens, c'est celle d'une époque calme et paisible.
Hergé was 11 as World War I ended and the interwar period began, but no one thought of it as interwar. People wanted to forget the horror and enjoy the blessings of peace, electricity, motor cars, cinema, gramophones, and holidays for all. Belgium, a battlefield in the war, had matured as a nation.
C'est avec faste que l'on vient de célébrer le 100e anniversaire de la naissance de notre patrie en présence du roi Albert et de la reine Elisabeth.
The stars of the early cinema captivated the young Georges Remy. All their gestures would reappear as gags and mannerisms in his own stories. Illustrated books were part of his childhood reading. Alain Saint-Augin's Zig and Puce, with its themes of memory and wandering, was a major discovery for Hergé. So was the work of Benjamin Rabier. Its animals inspired the early adventures of Tintin.
Ces gens, tous ces créateurs de bandes dessinées, tous ces artistes, tous ces héros de bandes dessinées ont eu certainement une influence sur ce que j'ai fait par la suite. Mais il y a une découverte encore qui m'a marqué beaucoup plus profondément, qui a eu une importance beaucoup plus considérable sur ma vie, et c'est celle du scoutisme. où j'ai découvert là un esprit tout nouveau, d'abord l'amour de la nature, l'esprit de jeu, l'esprit d'équipe, la camaraderie, la parole d'honneur, aussi la bonne action qu'on essaye de faire tous les jours. Enfin bref, tout ce que nous a apporté l'invention de Baden-Powell.
25 000 scouts acclament Lord Baden-Powell, créateur et chef mondial du scoutisme.
Continuez à pratiquer votre scoutisme, non seulement pour la distraction et le plaisir que vous en retirez, mais pour la joie de lui consacrer tous vos efforts sous la forme de bonnes actions et d'amitié envers les autres.
The former Boy Scout sometimes drew on his past. His secondary education was at this college, where the teachers were monks. Young Georges was often top of the class, except, would you believe, in drawing. He was to catch up later. Hergé was one of these Catholic scouts. It was in a paper called The Belgian Boy Scout that he made his debut. One important, crucial character in Hergé's life was Father Vallée. Editor of the Catholic newspaper The 20th Century, he also devised The Little 20th for younger readers. Hergé was put in charge of it. It was here that Toto, the Boy Scout, developed into Tintin, the reporter.
J'étais employé dans un journal et il y avait au-dessus de moi, il y avait le rédacteur. Et au-dessus du rédacteur, il y avait le reporter. Le reporter, c'était le grand voyageur. C'était d'ailleurs l'époque où il y avait la croisière jaune, où il y avait Alain Gerbault, où il y avait tous ceux qui parcouraient le monde, les grands journalistes comme Albert Londres et Kessel. Et j'ai voulu faire de Tintin, justement, un reporter de journal qui lui aussi allait voyager. Et pour son premier voyage, la chose qui m'a paru la plus importante à l'époque, c'était ce pays dont nous parvenaient des échos bien souvent terrifiants et en tout cas extrêmement contradictoires, c'était la Russie des Soviets.
In 1917, an empire had collapsed. The Tsar of all the Russias and his family were massacred. Some saw it as an example to follow, others reacted with panic. The 20th Century was a Catholic paper, and Catholic then meant anti-communist. The Bolshevik, with his knife between his teeth, was the enemy. Tintin's first adventure was inspired by the memoirs of a former Belgian consul in Russia. In Moscow Without Veils, Joseph Douillet drew up an impressive indictment of the Soviet Union. Tintin, too, discovered that only a good communist could survive, that in the new Russia there was only terror, desolation and famine. The secret police were the real masters, while foreigners were fooled by propaganda. Having survived so perilous an adventure, Tintin and Snowy returned home to a triumphant welcome. A welcome fit for heroes, and there were plenty of heroes. One of them was Charles Lindbergh, who'd just flown the Atlantic. Truly, the world was shrinking. The Great War had encouraged a taste for adventure. Between 1923 and 1929, Alain Gerbault sailed round the world single-handed, a triumph of polar navigation. The naval workshops brought out giant ships like the Queen Mary. They would carry millions of passengers, as well as the dreams of those who could never afford to sail on them. The Queen Mary and the French liner Normandy battled for years for pride of place. It was also the golden age of the foreign correspondent. Colonial expositions stimulated public interest in the colonies. So did record-breaking flights into Africa.
1925. Edmond Thieffry, lieutenant aviateur aux nombreuses victoires, proposa de relier la Belgique au Congo par la voie des airs. Un appareil fut construit à Bruxelles. À vol d'oiseau, 6250 km séparent la Belgique de sa colonie. Plus de 60 000 Européens y vivent aujourd'hui, dans des régions admirables qui produisent quelques-unes des richesses économiques du globe.
It was in this context that Tintin and Snowy set sail for the Belgian Congo. Africa, with a capital A. They were expected. Tintin came mainly to remind the blacks that it was the white man who made their locomotives work, and their brains as well. Tintin's attitude reflected an era when the West made a sacred mission out of spreading civilization. Hergé simply consulted the newspapers for his material. The white man's technology either terrified the Africans or made them marvel. But we should remember that many Europeans thought a man was hiding under the table when Edison played his gramophone. For the young visitor to colonial expositions in the 1930s, the Congo was also an immense reservoir of wild animals. The earnest commentaries of the time seem awfully naive today.
Coloniser, c'est civiliser. L'école est à la base de la civilisation. Les missionnaires ont compris la nécessité de dégager des liens de l'analphabétisme, cette masse noire d'Afrique.
In a later edition of Tintin in the Congo, Hergé himself felt obliged to substitute a lesson on arithmetic for the earlier one on politics. In 1931, when Hergé was 24, Tintin set off for America, a world 1,000 times newer even than today. Chicago, a giant slaughterhouse for both cattle and gangsters, rivaled New York in the headlines. The reports coming out of America were divided between wonder and horror. What is man coming to with all this? People asked. Tintin, of course, got into many tight squeezes, but he always got away. True to his Boy Scout training, he was chivalrous and incorruptible. Hergé criticized white Americans for exploiting the Redskins and taking over their land to build a forest of skyscrapers. Tintin soon shook off the rather superficial attractions of the New World, so did his creator.
Oui, jusqu'à présent, dessiner des aventures de Tintin, c'était un jeu, c'était une farce, une vraie petite farce. Mais à ce moment, j'ai rencontré un jeune Chinois, dont le nom était Chang Chongzhen, et qui m'a ouvert les yeux sur la civilisation chinoise et qui m'a fait mieux prendre conscience d'une sorte de responsabilité que j'avais vis-à-vis des lecteurs. C'est à partir de ce moment-là que j'ai accordé une plus grande importance aux détails, à la documentation, et faire en sorte que les histoires soient plus justes, plus vraies.
The Blue Lotus was a turning point in Hergé's works. First, it marked the start of his friendship with a Chinese student, Zhang Zhongren. Zhang would advise Hergé and even help draw part of the book. Now, Tintin found himself plunged into current events at an international level. From Europe and America, warships set sail for Shanghai. The much yellow peril was threatening the whites living in China. The Japanese, on the slender pretext of Chinese sabotage, were starting a war with China that would become part of the Second World War. The League of Nations would prove itself incapable of stopping the Japanese war machine. The economical style of Chinese art had a crucial influence on Hergé's own style. His work developed a new clarity of line. Fiction and reality are intimately mingled in The Blue Lotus. Thanks to Zhang, Tintin acquired a deeper humanity than he had possessed in earlier stories. Zhang saved Tintin's life in turn, and Hergé did not yet know he and Zhang would be again many years later. In Europe, too, the threat of war was increasing with the crash of jackboots. Belgium was torn by political divisions. Some sympathizers with Greater Germany even took to wearing the uniform of the enemy. The rising tension was palpable. In King Ottokar's Scepter, the contemporary references were obvious. But King Ottokar's Scepter was a bit of a fairy tale because it had a happy ending. It's set in Soldavia, a country that has had a long struggle for independence. Soldavia is a mixture with the elements of England, a touch of the Vienna woods. It comes as no surprise to discover a singer who does not yet know she will become a diva. La Castafiori is singing on a volcano. The neighboring country, Borduria, is planning to attack. It has an economy mobilized for war and a rigid social order suggestive of the fascist powers. What would become of a Soldavia without Tintin? Tintin, who knew how to read between the lines. The world on the brink of war, Tintin set off on a new adventure. The land of black gold dealt with a scheme by a foreign power to dominate the world by selective sabotage of petroleum. Tintin investigated, but he had to stop his investigation in scenes not far removed from reality, for the situation was grave. May 1940, a black month. Overwhelmed by the Germans, Belgium surrendered. What was a Belgian to do when he was demobilized and the king declared, "Let us get back to work"?
C'est vrai, le roi, après la campagne des 18 jours, a prononcé un discours très important, à mes yeux en tout cas, et qui disait « Demain, la Belgique se remettra au travail ». Et c'est tout simplement ce que j'ai fait, je me suis mis au travail. Et il est certain, en ce qui me concerne, j'avais aucune sympathie particulière pour les Allemands, je ne connaissais pas d'Allemands, et tout ce que j'ai fait réellement, je l'ai fait bien sûr, j'ai dessiné des histoires de Tintin purement et simplement, seulement il est parti dans d'autres directions.
The story, The Crab with the Golden Claws, from which these pictures come, first appeared as a serial in the Belgium newspaper Le Soir, a paper controlled by the Germans. In this adventure, Hergé achieved a truly cinematic style. It was also in The Crab with the Golden Claws that Tintin first met a character who would loom large in later books, putting Snowy slightly in the shade. Captain Haddock. Hergé himself admitted to being surprised at the popularity of this amiable drunkard, a slave to his vice. In this book, the drawing, the graphic inventiveness, reached a new height. Of terrible oaths, the captain sows panic among his attackers. Hergé considered it one of his best sequences. The Germans, meanwhile, were attempting to seduce Belgian public opinion. Some were influenced. Others were won over entirely and committed themselves to the German cause. Artists in many fields escaped into fantasy. The results were often masterpieces. Hergé's work also took a new turn as he published two books with consecutive stories, The Secret of the Unicorn and Red Rackham's Treasure. Instead of going off to a foreign country, Tintin went back in time, climbing the family tree of Captain Haddock. Haddock could only be descended from an illustrious ancestor, Rackham the Red. Our heroes also learned of a family treasure, which they set off to find. A mini submarine came in very useful. It was invented by another new character, Professor Calculus. He became a regular from this story on. A happy ending. In future, Tintin could live the good life in his own castle of Marlin Spike. And if any minor repairs were needed, he had the wherewithal to pay for them. During the war, anti-Semitic German films were often shown in Belgian cinemas. Jews were made to wear a yellow star, and some of Hergé's drawings seem to echo this.
On m'a reproché cette image, mais c'est absolument à côté. Ça n'a rien à voir, cette image n'a rien à voir, cette étoile de David n'a rien à voir avec du racisme ou de l'antiracisme. Elle était mise là comme décor sur la scène du théâtre où se produisait une sorte de magicien pour accentuer le côté magique, c'est le côté cabale, le côté cabalistique, le côté abracadabra de l'histoire. Donc ça n'a strictement rien à voir avec, avec le racisme. Quant au reste, les autres accusations de racisme viennent, je crois, suite à un malentendu. Il ne faut pas oublier que les dessins de Tintin, tous les dessins, tous les personnages de Tintin sont des caricatures. Et la caricature consiste à accentuer les caractéristiques d'un individu ou d'un groupe d'individus. Par conséquent, ça a toujours l'air de se moquer de celui qu'on caricature. Et c'est la seule façon aussi de faire en sorte que dans une histoire, comme les histoires de Tintin, on sache exactement qui est qui, qu'il soit reconnaissable. Ceci dit, je reviens à l'image qu'on m'a reprochée, c'est celle du financier juif dans l'étoile mystérieuse. Je reconnais que le moment était très mal choisi pour faire une chose pareille. C'était à l'époque où commençaient ces persécutions contre les juifs. À ma décharge, je dois dire que je les ai connus que très peu. J'ai entendu parler de certaines choses, mais on a vraiment compris l'ampleur et l'horreur de ce qui s'était passé qu'après la guerre.
This explanation wasn't enough for post-war authorities. Hergé was blacklisted and Tintin ceased publication. Accounts were being settled. Some paid a heavy price. In the end, treating Tintin as a collaborator looked ridiculous. After a year in limbo, he and his friends reappeared, this time in their own weekly magazine. The reporter now owned the paper, one for readers of all ages. It was in the Tintin Weekly that Hergé's best-known story first appeared. It will be published in two volumes soon afterwards, Destination Moon and Explorers on the Moon. Listening to Professor Calculus, Captain Haddock reacted as most people would have at the time. Go to the moon in 5 years? Don't make me laugh. In fact, it took great faith in human ingenuity to believe in 1950 that the conquest of the moon would soon be a reality. But Hergé was convinced of it.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
These two books aren't ordinary science fiction fantasies. The conquest of the moon is there. It really is in detail.
Roger, 11, we'll pass that on, and it's going to look like
7 years before the first Sputnik, 11 years before Yuri Gagarin, 19 before Apollo 11, Hergé demonstrated the effects of acceleration in a horizontal position during the takeoff of a rocket. The effects of weightlessness inside a spaceship. Reverse thrust braking for the moon landing.
Contact light? Okay, engine.
A very similar spacesuit, too. And the kangaroo hops that are possible on the moon because gravity there is 6 times weaker. The same hops we would see from Neil Armstrong and Edward Aldrin in 1969. For Hergé, Tintin in Tibet was a peak in many senses of the word. A peak of friendship, firstly. Tintin alone believed that Zhang was still alive. Yes, Zhang, his Chinese friend from the Blue Lotus, had vanished in an accident. It was a peak in graphic design, too. Hergé was undaunted by the breakdown he was going through at the time. Advised to stop work, he threw himself into it. Numa Sadoul observed that it did Hergé more good than psychoanalysis. This book was also prophetic. Just as Tintin ended up finding Zhong again after so many years, so after 46 years, Hergé was to meet the real-life Zhong once again. The picture of an event. The picture of a dream which comes true like a cartoon strip. The journalist Gérard Vallée had spent years tracing him, and at last, in March 1981, he landed on a flight from China. It was him, Zhong. Straight away, a call to Georges Remy, Hergé.
Ah, je suis à Paris. Oui. Bonjour, bonjour. Oui, tout est bien.
A short flight and Brussels. Georges was there, still there. A crowd of reporters, who might well have chosen their careers because of Tintin, were there for the meeting.
Expliquer une émotion qu'on ressent. Comment expliquer quels sont les sentiments qu'on éprouve quand on retrouve après près d'un demi-siècle quelqu'un qui a été pour vous plus qu'un ami, c'est quelqu'un qui a, je le disais tout à l'heure, mais qui m'a ouvert les portes et les fenêtres de toute une civilisation dont j'ignorais tout pratiquement. C'était un monde que Zhang m'a ouvert.
Though seriously ill, Hergé had promised Vallée two things. I'll come to the airport to get Zhong, and I'll come to the party you've organized. Many of Hergé's friends came as well, sensing that this was something they wouldn't see again. Even Father Gosset, who had introduced Hergé to Zhong, was there. Who among the crowd did not feel a debt to the man who'd done so much to give the comic strip its credentials? Their presence showed how highly they thought of this old friend. They had not seen him for almost half a century. Some had never seen him. He was in all their hearts. Zhong did not disappoint them. He was just as they'd imagined. It was as if he'd stepped out of the Blue Lotus. He revisited the studios of his youth.
Dans mon école, mais...
Oui, vous revenez ici, vous avez été à 24 ans, 20 ans...
Plus demi-siècle.
Demi-siècle.
46 ans. Oui, c'est ça.
Voilà, avec tout ce que vous avez fait.
Ah, oui, oui.
Tout le monde fait. Tenez, je vais vous donner...
Ici, il est là, il est là. Il est là,
voilà.
Là, ici, ici.
Nous, c'est un nouveau silence. C'est du
voilà la photocopie.
Oui.
La copie de cela.
Mais maintenant c'est trop petit. La place qui est trop petit.
Zhong at the Brussels Academy of Fine Arts. Zhong and Hergé with Queen Fabiola. Pictures that moved all the guests at the party.
Thank you. Je voudrais profiter de ma présence ici pour dire à Chang une bonne nouvelle. Cette bonne nouvelle, c'est que depuis 46 ans qu'il a quitté son ami Hergé est devenu, et je crois qu'on peut le démontrer désormais, un des plus grands écrivains du XXe siècle. Non pas seulement parce qu'il a écrit des bandes dessinées, mais parce qu'il a élevé la bande dessinée à la dignité non seulement d'un art, mais aussi d'un style et d'une philosophie, il faut bien le dire. Parce qu'il y a des choses que la télévision peut faire voir et des choses que la télévision ne peut pas faire voir. La télévision peut faire voir des images d'histoire et des images de géographie. On peut voir une guerre, on peut voir une révolution, et puis on peut voir des paysages. Et il est vrai que les albums d'Hergé, dès qu'on voyage, se jettent à votre figure, on le voit partout. Il nous accompagne partout, de l'Amérique du Sud au Groenland. Mais ce que la télévision ne peut pas faire voir, c'est la profondeur de la pensée sous la modestie apparente des images. Et je l'avoue, et je voudrais en témoigner en public, lorsque il nous faut réfléchir, nous autres philosophes, sur la théorie de la communication, par exemple, ce n'est pas forcément chez des philosophes très sérieux et dans des traités très abstraits que nous allons chercher notre pâture. Pour ce qui me concerne, je trouve que, par exemple, les bijoux de la Castafiore sont une théorie de la communication autrement profonde que les traités usuels. Et il m'est arrivé, à la Sorbonne, d'avoir à faire un cours autrefois sur le fétichisme. Et vous savez que, sur le fétiche, les plus grands philosophes du 19e et du 20e siècle ont parlé. Et après avoir éliminé tour à tour les discours de tel et tel autre philosophe, j'ai bien été forcé, pour la profondeur de la pensée, de traiter de l'oreille cassée. Mes étudiants n'ont pas été du tout scandalisés lorsque, au bout d'une heure, la démonstration était faite que le philosophe le plus profond sur le fétichisme, c'était bien notre ami Hergé. Par conséquent, je voudrais dire à Chang qu'il a, dans son ami, non seulement un ami, bien entendu, dont nous fêtons aujourd'hui les retrouvailles, mais qu'il est à côté d'un des plus grands écrivains et d'un des plus grands penseurs de notre siècle. Je le dis avec émotion, mais je le dis, je crois, avec la plus grande certitude.
Jean, the friend of Hergé. A great man, Hergé, one of the greatest creators of characters who have become so familiar to us, because they are day to day, because they are immortal, because they are simply classics. Tintin and his friends are everywhere. The press uses them and the cinema has taken them over.
Attention, attention, amis de Tintin, vous êtes là? C'est dans ce beau jardin que commence à l'instant une histoire qui va vous laisser haletant. Et voici le héros de l'histoire. Regardez, c'est Tintin, le garçon qui n'a peur de rien.
Cet accent. La voix au téléphone ne parlait pas ainsi, capitaine. Cet homme n'est pas le professeur Bretzel.
1000 milliards de sabots. La porte est fermée.
Ce n'est pas tout, capitaine. Regardez.
Tintin! Au secours! Allez! Tintin!
C'est inutile, professeur! Montez dans la voiture!
C'est tournesol! Ces moussaillons de malheur enlèvent le professeur!
Ce sont sûrement des agents ennemis!
Merci, Tintin, de nous avoir amené le professeur tournesol!
Et elle, c'est ma sœur Nouchka. Et lui, capitaine. Les nouvelles sont bonnes?
Une lettre d'Istanbul.
Hein?
Mon nouveau carburant est au point. Enfin, presque. Une source d'énergie nouvelle est née. Le super Trifonium.
It was inevitable that Hergé's work would attract film producers. The books are laid out like film scenarios. The gags, the angles of view, and the fluidity of movement all suggest the cinema. Honours have been showered on Tintin. Did he ever imagine as he jumped from spot to spot, story to story, that he would one day be stationary on a pedestal? Does he remember that he did not climb to these heights alone? The modern day phenomenon of Tintin originates here.
À partir d'un certain moment, j'ai effectivement senti le besoin de m'entourer d'une équipe. Ça a commencé très modestement, mais l'équipe, il n'y avait qu'une personne, et cette personne, c'était Jacobs, Edgar Pierre Jacobs, l'auteur de Marc Jaune, de SOS Météor, de Le Mystère de la Pyramide, qui est notre Wells de la bande dessinée. Ensuite a suivi Jacques Martin, qui lui a créé un petit personnage de Gaulois, enrôlé dans les armées de César, à Lix, et où il est, c'est ce qui est tout à fait documenté sur cette époque. Il y a eu Jos Lux, qui, sous son nom de guerre, Joël Azara, publie les aventures et les mésaventures d'un petit soldat japonais qui s'appelle Takatakata. Qu'est-ce qu'il y a? Il y a encore Roger Leloup, qui a créé les aventures d'une jeune japonaise électronicienne, les aventures de Yoko Tsuno. Il y a eu aussi un dessinateur qui ne fait pas précisément de la bande dessinée, mais de l'illustration, et alors qui s'appelle Bruno Cassirs. Il y en a eu d'autres encore, il y a eu Guy Tsissi, mais qui a évolué autrement, il y a eu Gion, qui fait aussi une bande dessinée d'ailleurs, dont Monsieur Magellan.
There's all sorts of mail, and plenty of it. Please forgive Tintin for not answering you personally. Think that there must be an army of skilled draftsmen behind Tintin. Not at all, but there is a recipe. Copy it and you may become famous. Hergé would see his collaborator, Bob Damore. Bob Damore would see Hergé. They consulted regularly. The recipe? Quite simple. A pencil, a rubber, some paper, and a glimmering of an idea to start with. Every page must carry a maximum of information and make one want to go on reading. A good layout is vital. Gestures must be just so. The readers are particular.
Je pense que le bras est bien à sa place comme ça. Et voilà.
Ok, merci, merci Bob. Oui, parfait. Tout à fait bien. Tout à fait bien. Parfait.
The pose is refined until the drawing is up to the story. Simple, clear, readable, and plausible. The concern for detail is real. Wasn't the Black Island redone because the British criticized the car number plates, the street signs, and the policemen's uniforms? The widest possible range of reference material is essential. Tintin kept his plus fours for a long time, but the things around him always changed with the times. Scene setting is crucial. The reader has to be there. This attention to detail helps establish characters as real people and makes objects convincing. Look no further for Marlon Spike. It's here. In Cheverny, Loire-et-Cher, France. Next come the ink drawings, then the colouring. Colour is used to reflect the mood of a story, but always within the bounds of realism. Costume details set at the beginning mustn't change along the way. The postman would collapse under the protest mail. It takes all of this and many other things for a little fellow who has long conversations with his dog to fly from Belgium all over the world. The print runs are constantly increasing. This plant can produce 100,000 books a day. The total number of books printed must have reached 100 million. The translations can no longer be counted. Tintin is published in French, English, German, and Italian, but also in Finnish, Indonesian, Japanese, Chinese, Hebrew, Arabic, and Afrikaans. Why? A mystery. Maybe it's the philosophy of the creator, who always believed the games remain the same, even if the labels on the boxes were different.
Tintin est un regard amusé et sceptique sur le monde et sur les événements. C'est lorsqu'il y a une phase sérieuse dans mes histoires, c'est immédiatement suivi par un sourire, comme le jour succède à la nuit, comme les deux faces d'une même médaille sont inséparables l'une de l'autre, l'inverse et le revers, elles sont inséparables, pourtant elles sont tout à fait différentes, c'est ça, quand au sérieux de l'histoire succède immédiatement un sourire. J'ai aussi tenu à être libre, à garder une indépendance totale vis-à-vis de toute conviction même. Et c'est un peu ça qui fait la caractéristique de Tintin. En fait, le capitaine, quand il se fâche, c'est un peu moi quand je me fâche. Que Tournesol, quand il est distrait, c'est moi quand je suis distrait. Les deux Dupont, quand ils font une bêtise, c'est moi quand je fais une bêtise. En fait, Tintin, c'est un peu moi.